Hey, I'm Tanya, your resident behavior analyst, and welcome to my Understanding Tantrums series. This is part two. Part one came out last week and was all about the importance of understanding the motivation behind your child's tantrum. I talk about the five main motivators or purposes for their behavior during those tantrums and why it's important to identify it before you know how to respond to it. And that's going to help you either reduce tantrums, maybe get rid of them. Obviously, you're never going to get rid of 100% of tantrums, but you can reduce them because you can teach your child a better behavior to engage in to get what they were looking for in the first place. So what their motivation or the purpose of their behavior was. So since I explained what the five motivations or purposes of behavior could be in the last video, today I'm going to teach you how to actually identify them. Behavior analysts look at the ABCs of behavior in order to understand what the motivation is behind them. The ABCs stand for A, antecedent, B, behavior, and C, consequence. An antecedent is what happens right before the behavior. Sometimes it's referred to as a trigger, which it kind of is. It's whatever it is that happens right beforehand that triggers the behavior to occur. Behavior, that one's an easy one. The behavior is just whatever behavior a child is engaging in during the tantrum. So that is usually varied depending on the child. Some of them are screaming, some of them squeal, some of them, sorry, I'm laughing because there was recently a kid that I worked with whose sibling would whistle like a teapot. It's hysterical. I don't even know how it would happen, but he would just start up and then get to a really, really high pitch and he would sound like a teapot and I died. But anyway, other behaviors might include throwing things, you know, just falling to the floor, melting to the floor, like flailing their arms and legs. Those are all different behaviors that the child engages in during the tantrum. And then, of course, there's the consequence, which in layman's terms, you think that a consequence is what the punishment or the discipline is for the behavior. But in behavior analysis, we refer to the consequence as simply what happens right after the behavior happens. So it's important to know what happens right before the behavior happens, what the behavior is, and what happens right afterwards. Why do you need this information? It's gonna tell you what the motivation is. So for example, if I have a child that is screaming, that's our behavior. Usually I start with the behavior and then I look back and forward to figure out the other two. So for example, you are putting your child in the cart at the grocery store, and the minute your child's feet touch that cart, they start screaming. And you decide you don't want to deal with it, you give them other options, and you put them down. So in this instance, the behavior is screaming. We'll call that just one behavior. And then the trigger, or what happened right before the behavior, was you putting your child in the cart. So that's what we know triggered it. And then right after the child screamed, the consequence of that behavior for that child was you putting them down. You gave them other options, but ultimately you put them down. So let's think about the motivation behind the screaming behavior. If the trigger was being put into the cart, then I think we can assume that that screaming was most likely because your child didn't want to go in the cart. So if your child's motivation was to get out of being put in that cart, and the consequence that happened, if you look back, was to get put down and get out of being in the cart, you have just kind of given in to your child's motivation, the purpose of their behavior, right? They learned that worked for them. So they're more likely to do that the next time that you go to put them in the cart because it worked for them this time. And the more that they come into contact with that consequence, and the more it works for them, the more likely it's going to keep going for a long time. That's kind of what keeps tantrums going for long periods of time, and why you're like, why is it never better? Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. You never know. A second example might be if you're speaking to someone else and your child comes up and says, Mom, 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 you know, I don't need to keep going. You know what it's like. And it doesn't stop. And then finally you give in and you turn to them and it doesn't really matter what you say because you're now giving them attention. So whether you say, you need to wait a minute, or you say, what do you need? You've acknowledged them and you've given them attention for the behavior. So that's a whole nother conversation on the next video. But for now, let's look at this scenario. We've got the behavior, which is repetitively saying your name and it drives you crazy. Then we have the antecedent or the trigger, and that is you speaking to another person. And then we have the consequence, what happened right after they repetitively said your name. Doesn't matter how long it is, as long as they've said it more than once, they've repeated it. The consequence was that you gave them attention, either in the form of a reprimand or a prompt to go do something else or a question about what they need. It's a form of attention. So if I look at this and I'm trying to figure out what the motivation was behind my child's behavior, if I know that when the behavior happened, which was the repetitive naming, then what happened right afterwards was they got attention. So most likely, if this keeps happening, if they keep repeating your name over and over again to get your attention, it happens a lot with toddlers. It's because you've accidentally shaped them. So the motivation behind that behavior is your attention. And you probably know that, but you're probably like, okay, well, how do I fix it? And I have an answer for you, but it's in the next video. This video is just all about understanding how to identify what that motivation is. And this was a fairly obvious example, but some of them aren't so obvious. So what I tend to do, just because it's part of my job, when I'm working with kids is I collect data on it, which is a little nuts. You don't need to collect data on your child. But if it's a really tricky behavior that you can't really tell, then it might help if you write it down a few times, like just one day. Every time your child engages in that one specific behavior, maybe it is just a full-blown tantrum. That's fine if it has like a bunch of little behaviors in it. But anytime they have a tantrum, you write down what happened right before and what happened right after. And at the end of the day, take a look at that, because I always look for a pattern in the behavior. So if you see that there's a common type of trigger where you're telling them they can't have something, or they're trying to get something, or they wanted your attention, and there's a common consequence where maybe you're giving into these things without noticing because you've reached your wit's end and it happens, then you can start putting it together and figuring out what's the main reason for a lot of these tantrums. And if you identify what that motivation is or the purpose is, then as in the next video I'm going to explain, you can actually put in responses or behavioral strategies in place to actually reduce those tantrums, because you can make them better by putting other things in place to teach replacement behaviors. A couple of quick things about motivation. Number one, motivation sometimes changes during a tantrum. So maybe their motivation at first was to get something, but maybe they come to understand that you're not going to give in. Then they decide that they want your attention. They want to know that you know that they're upset, if that makes sense. I think we've all seen this with kids. You've upset them, they're angry, and so they continue to engage in the behavior even though they understand they're not going to get it, but they're like, fine, well then you get to suffer along with me and I want to make you upset. It's also important to keep in mind that the motivation or the purpose of the behavior might be different every time. Obviously, they're having multiple tantrums every day, every week, but every time they have a tantrum, it's going to be for a different reason. So it's helpful to remember to look at the antecedents and the consequences or the triggers and what happens right afterwards to help you identify the motivation in that specific instance, so you know how to respond as a consequence to that and you don't accidentally reinforce the bad behavior, which means it'll keep it going. And the last thing to keep in mind is something that we call setting events. That just means keep in mind whether your child is sick. Are they hungry? Are they sleepy? Are they thirsty? Do they need their diaper changed? Pull up changed? Whatever. Keep in mind, you know, the time of the day, they're more likely to get cranky in the evening. all of these things are going to contribute to tantrums and the likelihood of them happening and how long they last and the intensity of each tantrum. So yes, it's helpful to know the triggers and the consequences. And once you know that motivation, then, as I'll explain in the next video, how to respond to it so that you can teach them better behavior to engage in instead. But sometimes you do have to keep in mind, it might just be one of those things, you know, they're hungry, they're cranky, they don't know how to tell you. And you have to understand it. And I don't know, maybe nap time is the answer to that at that time. Or maybe you just kind of have to wait it out and there was nothing you could have done to avoid it. But in my experience, and I've been doing this for 10 years, is that knowing the motivation really helps to teach them a better behavior to get what they were looking for instead of engaging in the problem behavior, such as tantrums. I hope that helped. I know that was a lot of information. I know it can get a little tricky. If you have any specific behaviors that you're not really sure the motivation of, I'd love to hear about it. Let me know down below. Let's brainstorm together. This happens all the time. If you want a copy of an ABC data sheet, if you don't want to make your own, let me know. I'll create one, no problem. I've got tons of them. I make each one for each kid, so it's easy. Otherwise, I will see you in the next video where I'm actually going to talk about, all right, you know the motivation. What do you do with that information? And I look forward to seeing you next time. So don't forget to subscribe. Hit the notifications, you know the drill, and I'll talk to you then. Bye.